Welcome again at Evolutionary Psychology to better understand your world, a YouTube video channel about the power of evolutionary thinking. Animals and plants are not our main subject of discussion. People, politics and societies are. Inspiring, sometimes controversial, but always stretching your mind. We have explored cooperation and the evolution of our own species. Now we dive into a rather different topic. One maybe you might not expect in a channel about evolutionary psychology, but we will see that it neatly fits into the same frame of thinking. We are going to explore innovation, the processes behind renewal and development. This topic, more than anything else, will show you how much genetic and mimetic evolution are the same, and understanding the one helps you to get grip on the other. But first, we take a recap at the most important steps in the evolution. Evolution is all about innovation, the process of getting better adapted to an ever-changing environment. It started at a simple level, the ability to replicate. In this stage, we are talking about simple chemical structures, which had the ability of making copies of themselves. They couldn't move, they couldn't grow, they didn't eat, it had no senses, nor could it orient itself in space. It could only copy itself, that's all. And this simple fact made it into something living. Making copies wasn't always going flawless. Errors occurred. We call them mutations. Mutations undergo a selection process. Most errors are just that, errors. But by chance, sometimes an error turns out to be an improvement. Stage 2. Natural selection weeds out the unfitted and selects the best mutations. Life remained for a very long time at the level of single-cell organisms. That is, the things that can copy themselves. They are only singular units. We are talking about the first billion years of life on Earth. The third stage is the emergence of metazoans, multicellular organisms. This is the originating of teams. Think back to our video on cooperation. Single-cell organisms discovered that they had much more survival power when working together. We met the Portuguese man of war, an in-between form of multicellular life, a temporary cooperation. But it worked. But in the end, it was overruled by permanent teams. It turned out they had a clear advantage on single-cell and temporary multicellular systems. Hence, almost all complex life forms we encounter today are permanent teams. And as we saw, the longer and more intense the cooperation, the harder it will become to return to a solitary life. But metazoans had a serious problem evolving when reproducing in the old school way. That is, by each cell only copying itself. This takes too long before sustainable innovations are established. The answer was found in sexual reproduction, the mixing of teams. This proved to be a big leap forward. I will tell more about this in a moment. The last stage is sexual selection. We do not cover this issue here, but we will explore it thoroughly in a video on male-female differences. This is the journey of the development of life on Earth. But let's for a start zoom out a bit more and look at the very big picture. When did things come into existence? Science talk about the Big Bang, some 13 billion years ago. What was there before the Big Bang? Did time, space, matter, and the laws of nature exist? I don't know. An unanswerable question. Just like who created God? Or what was there before God? Brain breakers I won't torture myself with. But if you want to, hey, go ahead. So, 13 billion years ago, it all started. The Earth got its present shape and temperature about 4.5 billion years ago. Then it took only 1 billion years before the first life forms appeared on Earth. This was no more than the simplest of chemical structures with the ability to make copies of themselves. Life stayed at this primitive level for quite a long time, so not much happened. Then, half a billion, 500 million years ago, life made an outburst. In a relatively short period of time, a broad range of more complex life forms emerged. Teamwork and sexual reproduction came into existence. This was the birth area of the really more sophisticated life forms, and most of the modern species have their very first grandparents in this area. We call it the Cambrian explosion because of the huge numbers of new life forms emerging in a relatively narrow time slot. I want to tell you a little bit more about what happened in this special era. Until then, we had only protozoa, single-cell organisms. They made copies of themselves. The occasional mutant, which was not weeded out but appeared to be a step forward, benefited only his own family line, that is, only his own offspring. The rest of the species enjoyed no advantage of this isolated innovation. Evolution was, in comparison to its later form, an extremely slow process. Then cooperation, teamwork emerged. The problem of slow evolution the single cell had now became an even more serious problem. I will explain what solution came up in the end. For this, I will use an oversimplified example, just to explain what was happening. Take for example a lion. It is built up of a lot of genes, each with its own role. You need a gene for running fast, a gene for strong claws, and a gene for a stomach that can digest meat. And, as I have said, it's a simplification. In reality, all these traits are built up on complex interactions of multiple genes. But to stick to the oversimplified example, only in the combination of these three genes, they make a viable lion. If one gene is missing or is not performing well, the whole cooperation becomes a failure. In the times of single cell forming groups, think of the Portuguese man of war, and with only individual copying as a means of replication, evolution of the group, what we now would call the lion, dependent on each of the participants making a move forward simultaneously, exactly on the same moment, exactly synchronized with all the other participants. And this without any coordination, without someone in command, no, purely by chance. You get the point? For single cell organisms, evolution was a painfully slow process. For these groups, it was infinitely more slowly, in fact, practically impossible. In other words, if life kept going on the old way, the feats of the Cambrian era could never have been accomplished. Life was in need of something completely new, a revolution that would solve all the old problems, something truly innovative, a brilliant solution never seen before. And this innovation did appear on the stage, and it was sex. Sex truly was the big leap forward. Evolution of multicellular organisms always requires an external and an internal fit. The genes for claws have to be adapted to the genes for a meat-digesting stomach and to the genes for fast muscles. Only in combination, these constitute an effective lion. And as a group, they are adapted to the features of the environment, the presence of prey animals, their speed, their ability, ability to fight back, etc., etc. The genes of a lion can be seen as the designers and engineers building an aeroplane. One expert knows all about wings, the other has specialized in motors, and a third knows everything about navigation systems. Together they built an aeroplane. And just like in a lion, the motor has to be well adapted to the wings. Once ready, the specialists are no more than passive passengers inside of the aeroplane, just like our genes in our bodies. When does sex come into the equation? Well, think about it this way. What are you going to do with a team of two excellent motor and wing specialists, but with a lousy navigator engineer? Evolution finally got a solution for this sticky problem: mixing teams. The essence of sex is that teams exchange specialists, genes in the case of our bodies. On many occasions, the new team will not get any better. You just interchange a lousy navigation specialist for a lousy motor specialist. But the probability that by chance, once in a million times, a team is formed with an excellent motor specialist and with a good wing specialist and with a good navigation equipment builder is much, much higher than waiting within a team until the least performing member was willing to better his life. Furthermore, once the golden combination finally is formed, it can be multiplied endlessly. So this special occurrence had to happen only once. That's enough. This is called the bottleneck hypothesis. Not all members of a species reproduce. In fact, In some cases, only a very tiny minority does. We know, for example, that humans have at one time in their evolution been reduced to some 10,000 individuals, from which we all descend, the number of an average village. This didn't mean there were no more than 10,000 people walking on Earth, but the descendants of all the others didn't make it till the modern times. So they probably lacked some very special properties the lucky 10,000 had. So by teamwork and sex, life made a huge leap forward. Evolution shifted from a lower to a higher gear. The abundance of life on Earth has, as we saw, its origins in the Cambrian explosion, an area of immense importance. So never underestimate the impact of sex. In fact, we will see that ideas can have sex too, but that's something for later. For now, we are going to focus on a very peculiar and very important phenomenon in evolution, convergences. Sex will enter the story again later. Convergent evolution is the phenomenon that very different, totally independent lines of development end up with almost exactly the same solutions. One might think evolution can pick solutions out of an infinite database, an infinite number of possibilities, which is theoretically true. But what really happens is that every time solutions are picked of a rather limited set of preferred solutions. Let's have a look at this limited set. I'll give you a number of examples, but there are many more. The first example is the camera eye. It evolved independently in snails, octopuses, reptiles and mammals. Much chosen so, but not the only option, as the facet eyes of flies prove. But this has evolved only a few times. Birds, bats, flying fish, pterodactyls, little dinos, and insects all have wings and can fly. But bats didn't look at birds and thought, hey, that's a clever idea, let's do this too. No, it evolved completely independent from birds. No imitation, no genetic ties, independent evolution ending at the very same point. Navigation by sound waves. Bats use it, dolphins do it, and Asian and South American swifts all have evolved exactly the same systems. Bipedalism. We see it with birds, men, Tyrannosaurus rex, and kangaroos. Antifreeze chemicals in the blood. Fish, both in the Arctic and in the Antarctic seas, use it. And there is no genetic connection between them. We are speaking of entirely different species, divided by tens of thousands of miles and huge amounts of, for them, impenetrable warm water. Another example of convergent evolution is living in social communities. See the many species of colonies of ants, bees and mammals. The swim bladder. Fish, jellyfish and mollusks use it. A hooked beak. Parrots, birds of prey, octopuses, triceratops, a species of dino, all ended up with the same solutions. The fish shape. Of course, fish, but also dolphins, penguins, seals and otters have it. And you might guess why this happens. There's only one body shape superior if you want to move fast and efficiently to water. A shark and a dolphin do resemble each other much more than a horse and a dolphin do. But the latter are far more closely genetically related than the first two. Poisonous fangs. Spiders, stingrays, stonefish, anemones, platypus, scorpions, millipedes, snakes, and so on and so on. The list seems endlessly. Maybe I mentioned too much examples, but realize this is only a small pick out of a very many more cases of convergent evolutions. Also on the level of ecosystems, we encounter convergent evolution. For example, in the ratio of herbivores and carnivores in a given area. Think of the similarities between Tyrannosaurus rex and Brontosauri, lions and wildebeest, Thylacinus and kangaroos, and wolves and caribous. Nature uses a set of preferred solutions, not an endless ocean of possibilities. And it's going to be even more exciting. Convergences do not only happen in nature, but also in our own cultures and in the evolution of our technologies. Technology philosopher Kevin Kelly has written a lot on this topic, and I'm heavily leaning on his ideas and his line of thinking. Convergent evolutions happen in technology and in other ideas. Think of the evolutionary theory of Charles Darwin. At the same time, Russell Wallace came up with exactly the same idea. Darwin did his investigation in South America, especially in the Galapagos archipelago. Wallace worked in Indonesia. When Darwin heard of Wallace's conceptual work, he speeded up the publication of his book. But if things would have gone a little bit different, Wallace would be the great man of the evolutionary theory. On February the 13th, 1876, two people patented the telephone, Alexander Bell and Eliza Gray. Both worked independently of each other on the same technological innovation and finished it on the very same day. Remarkable. The discovery or observation of sunspots happened in 1611 for the first time by four independent observers, all in the same 1 year. The thermometer was invented 6 times, the hypodermic needle 3 times. A number of independent investigators worked on the telegraph: Joseph Henry, Samuel Morse, William Cook, Charles Wheatstone and Carl Steinheil. We now know only remember one name, Mr. Morse, the man after which the Morse code was named. Neptune, the 8th planet, discovered by 2 independent observings in 1 year, 1846. And so I can go on and on. These were all more recent inventions, but the phenomenon was present during our entire history. Think of developments that took place in regions that had no contact between them, but still the same innovations emerged. Bow and arrow, cereals, maize, wheat, rice, sewed clothing, blowpipe with poisonous arrows, making fire, building pyramids, using steel and bronze, domestication of animals like cats, buffalo, llama and dogs. The invention of writing is another example of convergent evolution. It happened in Mesopotamia, 3000 BC, Mexico, 600 BC, Egypt, 3000 BC, and China, 1300 BC. The building of pyramids occurred in Egypt and Meso and South America. When Columbus for the first time came back from the Americas, he told the people in Europe how different people in the Americas were. However, he should have been more surprised by how similar Aztecs, Incas, and Mayas were to us. Just like us, they had cities, streets, stone houses, agriculture, hierarchies, kings, nobility, division of labor, fire, armies with officer ranks, courts, slaves, trade, religion, priests, temples, laws, taxes, bureaucrats, etc., etc., etc. Let's examine one example more closely. The blowing pipe with small poisonous arrows is a very useful device if you want to hunt small prey in densely leafed forests. For example, in the tropical rainforest of America, Africa and Indonesia. And, as you might have guessed by now, independently of each other, this device was invented in these three regions. It was not brought there by traveling hunter-gatherers, because these instruments are useless in open plains, and no archaeological remains have ever been found outside of the tropical areas where they are used. So, once man arrived in tropical rainforests, it was only a matter of time before the blowing pipe was to be invented, or should we say reinvented. But what has caused this strange phenomena, these cases of convergences? A lot of speculation is going on, and I will start by 3 ideas which are challenging but can also immediately be discarded. It is not, what Rupert Sheldrake is saying, caused by morphogenetic fields. These are a kind of metaphysical clouds to store information in and tap information out of when needed. Sheldrake did some very remarkable experiments that seemed challenging at first sight. For example, crossword puzzles were solved faster after they had first been solved in another country the day before. But soon many serious methodological flaws appeared, and his hypothesis is not taken seriously anymore. Erik von Däniken, see the picture, had an even more improbable idea. He was fascinated by pyramids, with the same structure which were built in Egypt as well in Mesoamerica and by the Aztecs and Mayas. Von Däniken thought the gods of religious scriptures were cosmonauts coming from outer space to perform genetic experiments on the human species. Pyramids served as a kind of beacons for their spaceships. As I said, highly improbable. A more serious investigator is Thor Heyerdahl. He made a little boat out of reeds from the Nile, and with it he crossed the ocean, using winds and tides. He has proven it is possible that people of the Old and New World had contact before Columbus entered the Americas, but he didn't prove it actually happened. What are better explanations? I will present some facets of the solution, and will combine the dots doing so. First of all, there is the availability of required technologies or ideas. You cannot do things unless some prerequisite conditions are met. Think of electricity and of microscopes. These tools facilitate the making of new tools, and they facilitate new observations, discoveries, and again the making of new generations of even more advanced tools and equipment. The best example is the observation of sunspots, which rested on the technological advancement of the telescope. If you have a proper telescope, it's only a matter of time before you spot the sunspots. In history, we see therefore a universal order in which new inventions appear. Flintstones always precede knives, fire and axes. Burials only take place after the invention of knives, where typically knives precede spades, necessary to dig graves. Textiles come after needles and threads. These were first used and perfected for connecting skins. Metal always comes after pottery. Ovens are first invented and perfected for pottery and later used for forging, because metal needs much higher temperatures. Cereals come after carrots and root foods. The latter are less complex to domesticate and grow. Not only technological prerequisites play a major role, but also natural and social possibilities and constraints are of the utmost importance. Pre-Columbian Native Americans discovered the wheel, but never made it to a technological commercial device. Why? Simply because they had no horses or oxen. We dive deeper in this subject in the next video. The printing press was several times invented in China, but always blocked by mandarins and emperors, because they saw it could undermine their monopoly on information. Another important phenomenon to get real grip on convergent evolutions are acceptations. This means existing structures acquire new roles. Limbs are evolved to walk, but in different species they later evolved for different additional roles: swimming, flying, digging, fighting, signaling, manipulating objects, or making clapping noises. Lungs are for breathing, but later they were used for making sounds too. Why? Instead of developing new sound organs, an existing structure could be used double, and only vocal cords in the throat had to be added to make sound from air. Evolution always picks the easy way out, even if that means it is causing future problems. The wings of a cricket were of course meant for flying. Making sound is, however, handy too. Developing lungs would be a detour that would take too long. So evolution used existing structures, feet and wings, and gave it extra roles, making noise by stretching over each other. The building of the flying ability of birds happened almost entirely behind the scenes. Strong muscles, oxygen transportation, feathers and brains developed for other reasons, but were one time in evolution brought together to create flying ability. The same happened with the electric eel. These fish can generate shocks up to 800 volts. Creationists have tried to use this as an argument why evolution, in their opinion, is a myth. Evolution goes in small steps, they say. So, what's the use of the ability to generate 1, 5 or 10 volts? You cannot kill a prey with it. So, creationists argue, the electric eel was created by God, with all the features it has at this moment in time and all the features it's always had since the beginning of creation. Sounds challenging at first sight, but when you probe deeper into it, you discover some serious flaws in their arguments. And the point is this: the capacity to generate electricity wasn't meant to kill prey in the first case. Several millions of years ago, the ancestors of the eel used it to orient themselves in muddy waters. Just like dolphins and bats do, they use the same sonar system. Later on, they added an extra function to it, to defend themselves, by confusing predators. Even a small shock can disorient a predator, which gives the eels a fraction of a second extra time to escape. And these tiny extra seconds can mean the difference between life and death, between being able to procreate or being a dead-end road in evolution. Only much later, when its power as a defense weapon grew and grew, it became an offensive weapon. Once your attacker is knocked out or dead because of your shock, you might as well eat him. So this is a story of ever-expanding acceptations. The same goes for our emotions. The ability to sense and process pain originated with physical pain to activate the right responses. Fight, flight or freeze. Or, if already hurt, seeking a safe space to let your wounds heal. Later, the same brain parts were used to process emotional pain. This way, a structure got an extra task added to it. You know, evolution is always about quick and dirty solutions. The same story goes for disgust. Started as an emotion to prevent us from poisoning ourselves, it got an extra role in the social domain. We can be disgusted by an act or opinion of someone else. And again, the very same brain structures are activated. Evolution is always about evolutions, not revolutions. The common pattern is always taking existing structures or technologies one little step further. Inventions are always accumulations of existing things. If I can look further than others, it's because I stand on the shoulders of giants, Isaac Newton said. Evolution always takes little step. Did James Watt invent the steam engine in 1769? Only partly. The most of it he copied from Thomas Newcomen, working on such a machine in 1712. And he used ideas of Thomas Savery in 1698, who built on a machine of the Frenchman Denis Papin, who worked on it in 1680, who again was inspired by ideas of the Dutchman Christian Huygens. So, as you have seen in the examples of convergent evolution in technology, inventions have a specific time slot in which they most probably are going to happen. That is when all the building blocks needed are there to be put together. This goes for technological innovations and for social evolutions. Think about the question, what would happen if Hitler died as a child? Wouldn't there be a Second World War? You can guess what my answer will be. Okay, let's call it a day. I hope I gave you some new ideas to chew on. Hope to see you in our next video. In our next episode, we go on exploring innovation. What did we mean by ideas having sex? What has the size of buttocks of oxen has to do with the space shuttle? Did pre-Columbian Native Americans invent the wheel? And why don't we live forever? Are there good reasons to die? And one very important topic, what are the dangers of monocultures? Want to know? Let's meet in the next video. If you like this video, share it, comment on it, and don't forget to like and subscribe.